And if I could ask Ruth, please take off the camera, please.
Madam Chairman, members of the Standards Committee, Andy and I have lived peacefully in a small village of Full Sutton since 2004. In 2015, Andy joined the parish council, believing his knowledge of fundamental legislation would be a benefit to him. At the start of 2016, he opposed them on the issue of illegal road signage. Children's posters made into road signs hung on posts and hedges throughout the village. After this, they breached FOI and DPA legislation. In February 2016, I attended the Full Sutton Parish Council meeting, best described as a kangaroo court, and watched.
Mr. Stranger, I'm really sorry to interrupt, but we really need to hear you as a witness talking about the actual hearing that we're hearing today.
Can I please ask for a point of order? That's what the witness is doing.
The historical information and your personal accounts, whilst understandably you want to express it, we need to really focus on
With all due respect, Madam Chair, it is stated in this report that there was no evidence. My wife has provided evidence and so have these two gentlemen, and I would like to request that this council, in yourself currently, does not attempt to prevent political expression and a kangaroo court in this building. And I'd like to politely suggest to listen to my wife and these two gentlemen.
We're not in a position to comment on Poplington Council.
This is relevant.
And
this is relevant.
So we need to be focused on the findings of fact.
I understand that, Madam Chair, and the information I'm about to provide provides a backdrop to understanding about the hate campaign that I would like to talk about, which links into this official complaint.
Yeah, again, we're not really in a position to hear about the allegations that anybody in this room might want to be making against members of the public. This is a hearing around Councillor Strangeway and the investigation and the findings of facts.
With all due respect, Madam Chair, I strongly object at this point. It's clearly stated in the front of here that part of the reason I'm here, and I've stated there is a vendetta against me, and you're refusing to accept this evidence. This is nothing more than turning into a kangaroo court, and it's absolutely disgraceful. And I just beg with you to please give this lady 2 or 3 minutes, this gentleman 2 or 3 minutes, this gentleman 2 or 3 minutes. And not to do so turns this council into more of a mockery than it is currently held in the public domain.
No intention of being disrespectful.
You've been highly disrespectful.
Witnesses. So if you want to continue, but please bear in mind that I may end up stopping you again if we think that it's not relevant to this actual
Thank you. In 2016, February of the month, I attended a Full Sutton Parish Council meeting, best described as a kangaroo court, and watched our local community vilify Andy for 3/4 of an hour with their pre-arranged speeches during what should have been a 10-minute public session. Instead of calming the matter by explaining the road signs were actually illegal, East Riding Councillor Andy Burton said he didn't have a problem with them. It took an approach to ERYC's head of highways to confirm that Andy was correct and to ask the parish council to remove the said signs. An undercurrent of hatred has continued since, fueled by a nucleus of Full Sutton women who have made it their business to influence others in the Poplington Provincial Ward. Indeed, some of Andy's haters, a member of the Poplington Town Council and the clerk, are in the audience today. Since Andy has been elected, the catalogue of ridiculous and time-wasting complaints submitted by the same people continues to escalate against him, with the ERYC accepting them. How much money has been wasted in this process? Today's complaint is such an example. If you visit a certain Facebook site, Pocklington Area Local Politics, you will note it is created by the clerk of one of the local parish councillors. The clerk of Full Sutton Council is an administrator on this site, supported by one of the ladies who has submitted today's particular complaint, and who happens to be the wife of a Full Sutton Parish Councillor. I do have a copy of this to support if any member would like to see this. If you dig further, you will see that the second lady who submitted this complaint, and indeed many other such complaints against Andy.
I'm really sorry, but what you're telling us, I'm sure you feel very passionately about, but what you're telling us is not about the hearing that we're hearing today. We're not here to investigate members of the public.
You're here to investigate an obsessive campaign against me, and that is what I've been held to account.
Sorry, Mr. Strange, we're here to hear whether or not the code of conduct has been breached in terms of your role as a councillor, and that's what this panel will be.
Because I've stated the obsessive campaign and hedge cutting. So if there is no obsessive campaign which you are refusing to hear evidence of, all this committee is here to hear is about an hedge cutting at £10,000 cost to this authority. Absolutely disgraceful and waste of taxpayers' money. Thank you for confirming that.
I'm sorry, would you like to call the next witness?
Yes, I'm quite happy to do that.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr.
Strangeway. I'd like to ask the next gentleman, Mr. David Harris, to just step forward and just give him some support of these things that are true facts.
My name is David Harris. I'm a resident of Bocklington. Given what I've heard in the last 15 minutes, I'm not quite sure how to proceed, because I came here with the intention of speaking of my experiences with Andy Strangeway, which have been considerable, particularly in this building, relating to planning events in the last 5 years. But my comments are all ancillary to the points that you are trying to levy against him, which I do find, I have to say, incredible that we have formed this committee to review what seems to be minutiae. That's my opinion.
I think that whilst every opinion is always to be respected.
But it seems as though it is opinions that we are charging or levelling against Mr. Strangeway. I've heard no facts.
We're not here.
We've talked about facts, but I haven't heard them.
We're not here to debate whether or not the standards regime is
useless already, useless, you're trying to say. I appreciate that. It's totally utterly useless. It's totally subjected to subjectivity, and it's totally dominated by the Tory controlled council of this authority, and it's a disgrace and a waste of money to the taxpayers of this authority.
We are here to listen to. The process is that we've received a complaint, the complaint has been investigated.
After an hour in this court, Madam Chairman, forgive me, I don't know what the complaints are in any reality.
All the complaints are, with all due respect, David, is that I've stated there's an obsessive campaign against me which this committee is refusing to listen to evidence of. The investigation officer refused to listen to it, the committee are trying to close it down because they don't. It's an unfortunate fact, because what if this whole thing is about is to try and close Andy Strangeway's political expression down. And as you can be telling me, I refuse to do this, and I do not care what the fine of this committee is. I will continue to speak out. I was elected to serve my residents without fear or favour, and I will do that.
I think we need to move on.
I have one more witness, please.
One more witness. And I would really urge the next witness. What's your name?
John Banks.
John?
Banks.
Banks.
B-A-N-K-S. I didn't actually come here as a witness. I came here to observe what was going on. So I hadn't prepared anything before I came. I find this whole setup quite extraordinary. And I've made one or two notes as I've gone along.
I'm sorry, Mr. Banks, we're not here to.
Am I allowed to speak or not?
No, you're not. It's a silence of East Rank Council. And we've got a gentleman here who writes in our local paper called Councillor Owen, who wants to ban the word love.
Can I just come in at this point, just to say how it ranks over the
I'm just really introducing myself.
In terms of the hearing from the witnesses and the representations that are being made, I just want to remind people that it's around looking at the findings of fact that are set out in the report, and it's about challenging if you have any issues with regard to those that you disagree with. This is an opportunity, and bringing the witnesses in around focusing on the findings of fact to say that you disagree with the points that have been put forward.
With all due respect, Sarah, the finding of facts If we look at that, I don't know what page, because there's so many pages in here, and I've just been bombarded with this. Now, the finding of facts is we are focused on two aspects: obsessive
absolute
campaign
chaos.
And a hedge cutting. Nothing else. And that is why I asked him in the first instance to explain what each campaign was about. It is about, is there an obsessive campaign? Yourselves and the investigation officer has refused to look at this evidence or hear this evidence, and so all we are talking about at the cost of £10,000 is a cutting of an edge. Can this gentleman please speak?
Just make a point of it in relation to obviously the issues that you've raised around understanding the actual complaints. There has been the opportunity for you to see, to refer your documents to the solicitor or the representatives to do it.
With all due respect on that one, Sarah, we're not discussing legal points, we're discussing.
If you had any concerns, you really had a lot of understanding.
Can I make this up with all due respect? We're not talking about legal documents here. We're talking about the English language. And we have in the past weeks, Sarah, I've had two emails to you and asked for an explanation, and you've just cut and pasted, and I still don't know what the complaints are. As this gentleman said, nobody knows what these complaints are. The best we can get these complaints is there an obsessive care campaign, and shall we spend £10,000 because the councillor makes a comment about putting the hedge back? In this room now, we have one, we have two, we have three, we have four, we have five elected members. And we are wasting all this time discussing the cutting over net, plus that money. So I would request that this gentleman speak again, please.
Can we now move on? I'd just like
so we're going to silence this gentleman?
Yes.
Would did you want to make any further points, Mr.
Banks? Well, I wasn't allowed to make any points whatsoever before I was told that this was a completely irrelevant. Understand what the allegations are, particularly. One thing, because it's very difficult to follow your way around a document that you've not seen before. So I don't understand the complaints, and I don't really understand what it's all about. I view the blog that you keep referring to as something completely independent and not doesn't represent anybody, any councillor's opinion, and it's a private a blog and not an official one. I'd say that Councillor Strangway is a really energetic and hard-working person, and he tries to sort out all the problems ranging from potholes in the road upwards and so on. I also understand that he appears to make many enemies because of his energy and. And I reiterate David Harris's views about this, and that it's not considered by any of you that we are making relevant points, and I find that quite important.
Thank you.
Can I now just ask Mr. Pym, as investigating officer, if you want to question any of the evidence put forward by Councillor Strangway or any of the witnesses?
No, I've got
other
questions.
Mm-hmm.
Can I just ask Mrs. Tomlinson, the independent member, if you want to question any of the evidence put forward by the member or the witnesses?
No, I've said the opinions before, thank you.
Are any members of the committee would like to ask any questions of Councillor Strangway or any of his witnesses?
Is this still about the fact? Or happening with me? It's still about the fact.
It must always be about the fact. That's all we can hear.
I'd just like to ask Councillor Strangway about the complaints appear to be around the ones that are on page 7 that members of the public have been identified on the floor. I'm clearly the statement being made are there, so one person who keeps having an obsessive campaign against you. And the third one appears to be around contacting the employer.
Yes.
I suppose the question is, to what extent, as a ward councillor, do you think that, you know, people have a right to disagree? And I think with ward councillors, we do our best for people, but we'll always probably have some people who don't like what we do and who perhaps don't like us. Do you think it's appropriate to name those people on a website to say this person doesn't like me?
Yes.
Or do you think it would be more appropriate just to sort of accept that kind of goes with the territory?
Generally speaking, to a certain extent, you accept it. I fully agree with that. But when you have been at this onslaught for over a year, and these people are literally stalking you when you are going about your work as a ward member.
Can you just explain a little bit more about the stalking?
Well, for example, I went to see somebody yesterday about an issue. And I can only say something about this because of various reasons. But certain people took a photograph of where I was. And that was a Pockington Town Council person. And then that person gave that photo to Martin Cooper, who was also a Pockington Town Council at the far end. And then they put it on his Facebook. Now, that is clearly identified where I went about doing my ward work. That is clearly stalking. I parked a car up. And if it's just questioning, and I fully agree, Councillor Healy, we should just take it on the chin. That is a level that I've had for all this time. 2 days ago, I drove down my country lane, and there's a bucket left. I thought, actually, someone's going to hear it. And they didn't. So me, I'm in full transparency. That's why I then published. I've always done this. I have 19 websites for various things. And I put on there, I don't know if this is literal or this is flight tipping.
I suppose we're not here to judge members of the public and their conduct towards you. And I accept that some people have upset you. The question that we're judging really is whether you think it was appropriate to identify those people on your website.
Yes, I do.
So you do accept that you did do that?
Oh, yes, I totally accepted that Andy Strangeway put them on his website, and I will continue to do that because this is about political expression. And I and everybody in Pocklington who frequents Facebook is fully aware of all these people. So there are only about 6 or 7 people that have that and no one else has anything to do with it. They are vile. And this authority should not be allowed. They've got a conduct to be used for stalking purposes. So yes, I will name. And I will continue to name. And regardless of what this committee decides today, I will publish again. And I will continue publishing. And I believe that is my political expression. But of course, I will not do that in a general sense. But if any member on this committee was stalked so much in their ward on a public Facebook on a daily basis, it's not acceptable.
Any other committee members, or indeed Councillor Healy, any more? Councillor Hardy?
I'm not a councillor.
Oh, sorry.
I just want to explain where I'm coming from so that you know the context. I am not an elected member of this council. I replied to an advert for an independent member of this committee. And so therefore, I'm not political at all. I'm here as a member of the public. As a member of the public, and a member of this committee, I read these papers and I found the papers very, very difficult to understand. In fact, I read them 3 times before I understood.
Yeah, I agree.
So, and one of the things I found very confusing was the blogs. And about the fact that you are said to have put information on the blog in a private capacity, and you issued a disclaimer to that effect.
Is this a question for Councillor Spence.
No, I'm explaining where I'm coming from and that how I found it, I'm coming round to the plot and that being confusing. Because at one point you issue a disclaimer,
yes,
and obviously that is to protect you, the disclaimer,
okay,
because you're saying this is in my private capacity.
Of course it is.
But in the same, almost the same breath, as it were, you are then putting references to the council.
Yes.
And so therefore, I would suggest that the disclaimer is overridden by the fact that you are then referring to the council and your surgeries and things like that. If you're going to do a blog, a private blog,
yeah,
and to save confusion, you should then, I would suggest, cut out all references to the council and make it private and clear, and make it clear that you are using that blog for your own to demonstrate.
This is hardly, this is the opportunity to ask Councillor Strange way a question. The questions pertain to his...
do you understand that it can be very confusing if you put in the disclaimer and then after that you put in references to your role, your public role,
right,
as a councillor?
Unfortunately, what's not appeared in this report is that this site was started on March the 17th before I became elected on April the 7th. This is my political site. I fully agree that it can be confusing. That is why I requested this authority on both the disclaimer and the Article 10 rights to take external legal opinion. This would have cost £200 or £300, save all of this. Because my brief, which is more highly qualified, they've actually take cases to a court of law and no brief in this building can do, has stated that that is a legal statement. I appreciate it may be confusing for what we all are lay people, apart from one or two people in this room, but that is why I wanted the East Riding Council to do that, to take external, because but they refused to do that. But I fully agree that it is confusing.
Councillor Strangeway, do you accept that when you become a public figure,
okay,
the ability to be a private person,
yes,
is somewhat removed? And I accept the point that you started the blog before you,
yes,
were elected. But do you think it's quite difficult as a public figure, as a,
yes,
councillor, to be able to then make suggestions in a private capacity,
okay,
and to expect the public to be able to differentiate?
Okay.
Do you think that's acceptable?
This is not all suggestion. When that site was set up, I took very good legal advice. This authority has never referred external, because the simple reason, Council Healy, why they will not refer to external legal advice, because they will get back the answer they do not want, with regard to the disclaimer and with regard to my Article 10 rights. I have a right to freedom of expression. And as an independent, unlike a Liberal, a Labour person or a Conservative, everything I look at is my personal political expression. I can have a political expression of all that, of all that. It is not for this authority to say, and it is stated in legislation, that no public authority should interfere. By this very meeting in this room, this authority is interfering with my political expression.
Well, do you not think that the site that you've got is showing all the good stuff that you do?
Yep.
I mean, I've got a site as well.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about the electrics, the potholes, the,
yep,
campaigns, and keeping the public up to date,
yes,
is clearly in your work as a councillor. But But then you say that some of the things you say are in your capacity as a private individual.
No, so you don't think
there's a bit of confusion about when you're pronouncing, you know, as a private individual and when you're pronouncing as a councillor, when in fact it's all on the same
point? When we first looked into this, it actually states that this was my private site. At no point did I state it was my private site, I stated it was my political site. And that's why I established it when I established it. Whether I stop being a councillor tomorrow morning, 3 years' time, whatever I do with my political life, I think I've been a campaigner for many years on national issues. And that is what I chose to do with this site. I appreciate the confusing aspect, but that is why I asked the question earlier about whether our code of conduct is I've got a legal document. And it is not a legal document, because my rights are enshrined under British, EU and international law, and that kind of conduct cannot override that. And this authority is refusing to accept what is the law.
Councillor Strangeway, can I ask you, have you read the Code of Conduct?
Yes.
Were you given a copy when you became
yes.
a councillor?
Yes.
Councillor Strange,
I will come back to you.
I need to come back to public perception.
Yes.
And I can see the confusion that the public mm-hmm. would have with your box
okay.
and things like that. Can you see it from the other point of view? If you weren't a councillor and you were looking at this situation
yep. okay.
from outside of the
yes.
your own councillor, and can you tell me
okay.
how you would feel about it?
Right. I would feel rather disappointed that this authority and has dragged about five members into this building today for the sake of taking this external
no,
advice.
No, no, no. You to tell me
I'm asking
the
question
how they review your block.
I'm asking the question if
you
want
to talk
okay.
about who's talked about before. So I'll ask you the question again. If you were to councillor and you were looking at the blocks from the public point of view, your public perception would be what?
Is my answer inconvenient for yourself? Can I ask the question? I'll be able to answer it for me.
Excuse me.
That's a straight question. I'm just because you see.
Very polite to
your
councillor.
Right. Well, if you let me ask the question,
if you let me ask the question,
instead of cutting me off, please. Thank you very much. As I previously said to Mrs. Harris, I requested that this authority takes external legal advice because I appreciate it's confusing to the lay person. I overlap with some very, very talented briefs. Barristers, etc. That is a legal statement. And this Code of Conduct cannot override that, and not with this committee. That is fact.
I fully agree with what
Councillor O'Neill said. If I was looking at it as a layperson, I would believe it's confusing. That is why I requested this authority just to take a bit of legal advice. Because these people here have another 6 or 7 complaints coming towards you guys, such as their obsessive campaigning, their obsessiveness against me.
Okay, Mrs. Harvey, you had another question, I believe.
Yes, I do. As a councillor, you are expected to behave as a councillor. Is that right? According to the Code of Conduct.
The word be it. Sorry.
And there are certain boundaries that apply
okay.
to you as a councillor.
Right.
Do you agree with that?
No, not fully, I don't.
You don't agree?
No, I don't. Use the word behave. Is this taken into account my culture, your culture, whose culture is it taken into account? It is subjective. I'm a very working class lad. Most councillors and most people in this building are middle class. I speak as I speak. I've lived on the East Riding all my life. All my forefathers worked on the Yorkshire Wolf farms. And this is how I speak. You cannot make a judgment on somebody else's culture without appreciating their cultural heritage. And just because I've got a pair of shoulders and a booming voice, I am representing an area.